think this is on. I think we may begin, Mr. Desai. So our next session, for which we have a very distinguished panel, our former chair, Rajiv Kumar, a distinguished economist, and Admiral Chauhan, who has been involved in various India-Japan maritime conferences over the years, Ambassador Rangachari, a colleague with whom I have worked very closely during the days he was in charge of East Asia, and I was ambassador in Vietnam and then in Japan, Professor Kikuchi from Aoyama Gakuin, and Ambassador Alok Prashad, who has been ambassador also in Japan and with whom I had the pleasure of working when I was at my university by then. No longer ambassador, but I was a professor, and we had a lot to do with each other. Now, today we are talking about peace and prosperity in the Asia, and generally in the Asia-Pacific region. So we will not confine ourselves only to the India-Japan equation, but we will venture further afield. And since Ambassador Rangachari is one of our leading experts on China, I think we will hear some interesting insights on China and how we relate to China from this country and from Japan. As I mentioned in the earlier session, we have had a very productive relationship with Japan over the last several decades, centuries, but over the last 15 years, from the time of Prime Minister Modi's visit to India in August 2000, followed by Prime Minister Vajpayee to Japan in December 2001, there was a gap of 2-3 years, largely because of India-Pakistan problems, which is the reason given. And then we, after Prime Minister Koizumi came to India in April 2005, it's been a steady annual exchange. The global partnership between India and Japan, announced by Prime Minister Mori in August 2000, was expanded in December 2006 to a global and strategic partnership between Manmohan Singh and Shinzo Abe in his first avatar, in his first administration. And subsequently, we have seen that even 3 years of rule between 2009, when Hatoyama came to power, the opposition Democratic Party of Japan, followed by Naoto Kan and Noda, that the friendship with India, the connections with India, the engagement with India is totally bipartisan in Japan, whether it's the LDP or the now again they are back in opposition, the Democratic Party of Japan, as indeed it is here. Vajpayee started the engagement in 2000, Manmohan Singh carried it on for the 10 years that he was in power, and Modi from May 2014 has carried it further. His visit, in fact, in September 2014 saw one major breakthrough, and that was the removal of 6 of our entities from the list of that the Japanese had put consequent upon our nuclear tests in 1998. So that saw plus discussions on the US too, on nuclear energy and so forth, and a major declaration in which both prime ministers, if you read the Tokyo Declaration, acknowledged their debt to their predecessors. There is a wonderful paragraph, which if we forget a chance, we'll read it to you, where they both say that the India-Japan story is one which is a very deep one, and we both acknowledge our debt to our predecessors who have brought us to this point. The Prime Minister Abe was our chief guest in January 2014, and in 2015 rather, a return visit for Prime Minister Modi's. And then again he was here in December when the discussions had moved forward. We had a discussion just now about states. Five different agreements were made with five different states, which is a move forward by Japan, Maharashtra, Rajasthan, Gujarat, and two other states. But it's not the first time that chief ministers have been visiting Japan. In my tenure, Chautala came. Chandrababu Naidu is a frequent visitor. And Buddhadev Bhattacharya from West Bengal. All three states which are closely linked in many ways with Japan, and I'm sure this will come out. So now, if I may request, may I start from the left? May I start with Ambassador Alok Prasad and request him to give us his very insightful views on... why not from there? Why not?
Yeah. Thank you, Chair. And it's a pleasure to see Kulkarni ji here again, and I'm delighted to be invited to participate at this meeting. Having very happy memories of my stay in Japan, I'm delighted to see the trajectory that India-Japan relations have taken in recent years, and feel privileged to have played some small role in that development. I think our topic for today suggests peace and security in Asia and Asia-Pacific. Now, I personally prefer the more recent term which is being used more frequently, that is the Indo-Pacific. And although Secretary Hillary Clinton is credited with having coined that term, it was actually Prime Minister Abe who in his previous visit in 2007 had spoken of the confluence of the two seas and considering this entire region as one security issue. And these terms are not just geographical expressions, they actually underlie or reflect underlying geopolitical trends. So the term Indo-Pacific, I think, to my mind, it conjures two images. One, it sort of resets your mental image of the entire region as one security continuum, where it is comprising the Indian Ocean region, the South China Sea, and the West Pacific, where it is unlikely that conflicts will remain localized, and they will impact on the region as a whole. And I think secondly, just the very term Indo-Pacific suggests a more maritime dimension to the security order. In fact, it can be argued that there are two distinct orders emerging in Asia. One is the continental order, which is basically China-centric, and one is the maritime order, which is more amorphous, has more players. And I think that is where a lot of attention is going to focus in the future. It's also a region which, in a sense, happens to be bookended by India and Japan. We are at either end of the of this region. And in that sense, the India-Japan partnership, to my mind, is vital in ensuring future peace and prosperity of this region. And it is therefore very heartening to see how much we have developed our partnership. Ambassador Sait spoke about how this has been growing since about 2000, when after Japan came to terms with India's nuclear tests. But really, it was given a huge momentum when we declared a strategic, a global and strategic partnership in 2006. And since then, the prime ministers have been meeting annually. I think it was mentioned that Japan is the only other Asian country with which we have this arrangement, which reflects the importance that both sides attach to it. And I'm personally aware of how, despite a lot of difficulties domestically, both prime ministers have sort of tried to maintain this schedule, and it has been maintained throughout these years. Of course, we used to joke at that time that every time Prime Minister Manmohan Singh met a Prime Minister of Japan, it was a new Prime Minister of Japan. But I think that also underscores the point that Ambassador Aftab Seth made about the bipartisan nature of support for India-Japan relations. In fact, I'd go further that the political support from all parties reflects a sort of popular support for people of both countries to each other. There is a sort of sense of affinity, and which I'm sure we'll be exploring in subsequent sessions. So, but I clearly saw a sense of that when, after the Tohoku earthquake and tsunami, we sent a small disaster relief team from India. And they created a tremendous impression because the conditions were extremely difficult. And since they were still finding remains, they decided not to use any heavy equipment and literally worked with their hands. And the Japanese people were so touched by this gesture of the Indian team that they sort of literally joined in. The whole village was working along with our team to sift through the rubble, locate remains, locate possessions of people, personal possessions. So when they were about to leave, we organized a small function for them in the embassy just to sort of thank them and recognize their efforts. And we invited a few people, but our entire auditorium was absolutely chock-a-block with people who on their own heard about this and they decided to come. And Prime Minister Mori told this story. He said that, you know, at the end of the Second World War, when we were so down and out, Prime Minister Nehru sent us an elephant to cheer the children. And today, India has sent us 24 elephants to help us at our time of disaster. So I said that also sort of reflects the, you know, the popular support for Japan-India relations and in developing this partnership. Now, I don't want to go into a lot of details on this. I'm sure Admiral Chauhan will be speaking later about the naval exercises, which we are expanding. I think, in a sense, it all began when we rescued a Japanese ship from the Somali pirates. And I think that sort of immediately brought home to the Japanese the potential of the Indian Navy. And more recently, in the evacuation from Yemen, and it's surprising that this was downplayed by the Indian media, I guess everything good is, but the Japanese media made a lot out of it, that India rescued 50 Japanese nationals from Yemen. And they made the point that it was only India which had both the physical capabilities and the diplomatic outreach to be able to do this outlift from Yemen. And they were very, very positive articles written about that. So I think that naval maritime cooperation is increasing, which is very welcome. We do have bilateral exercises regularly. Also, they participate in multilateral exercises. And we are developing capacities to respond to disaster relief situations, piracy situations of the type that I've just described. I think it's another major development has been, and this was a big step for Japan at that time, to decide to provide defense-related equipment to India. And the first one was a US-2 aircraft. Those discussions are still going on, but we are hopeful that they'd be concluded satisfactorily. I think one could imagine extending this further into areas like submarines and where Japan probably manufactures some of the best in the world. But I think of more importance is the common values that both India and Japan espouse and represent, and their vision of a security architecture in Asia, which is open, which is inclusive, and which is based on the rule of law and certain principles. And I think that is where we can perhaps make the biggest contribution to peace and prosperity in the region. There is the question of what institutional forums, what institutional mechanism can be used for this. To my mind, the most appropriate seems to be the East Asia Summit, because I think this idea of the centrality of ASEAN works for everybody. To have ASEAN-based forums so that it's not, you know, none of the big powers are suspicious of the other dominating it. So in that sense, I think the East Asia Forum, which is led by ASEAN and includes all the major stakeholders, including the US, Russia, China, India, Japan, Korea, Australia, New Zealand, and of course all the ASEAN countries are all members of it. So it's not too unwieldy. It is has all the major stakeholders, and I think that could be a suitable forum for taking forward these discussions. I might just add I was just going to say that India's evolving view of itself in the Indian Ocean region. You know, starting from those days of Indian Ocean as a zone of peace, which where we almost wanted to wish away the foreign presence or the presence of, you know, foreign powers, which is not possible. I think we have now developed a more sophisticated understanding that yes, this is our region, we have a major responsibility here, but others too have vital interests in this region, and that we have to work along with them to secure peace and prosperity here. And India viewing itself now more as a provider, net provider of security to the region, particularly working with the small island states. And I think this is complemented by Japan revising its own constitutional guidelines to permit it to participate more in a bigger way along with other countries, which Japan calls its contribution to peace and security. I think that is very welcome to India. India has always felt that Japan should have a more of an international voice. It's a voice that needs to be heard. And it also opens up greater possibilities of us working in the future. Now, a word about, you know, Japanese decline, and as in the previous session, somebody spoke about the three aces that Japan has. And I think the biggest ace of all is the Japanese people. And I said, having lived through that period of the earthquake and the tsunami, I remember that first night I was going home at about midnight from the embassy, and there were literally thousands of people walking on the streets. People walked 20, 25 kilometers that night to reach home. And there was absolute silence. There was no looting, no rioting, no law and order issues, just people quietly walking. And I think that's the image which stays with me as a symbol of the resilience of the Japanese spirit, the ability to overcome adversity and to rise again. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Ambassador. Epitomize the Japanese spirit. May I request Professor Kikuchi? Yeah, you can go there if you wish.
You know, I have been studying international relations of the Asia-Pacific more than 30 years, but my understanding of Asia or Asia-Pacific stopped at the Thailand or Myanmar, and not beyond that. But for the last several years, India have been emerging a key player of the Asia-Pacific or Indo-Pacific. So I had many occasions to visit India to my experience. So today, title my presentation, Beyond U.S.-China Relations, Japan and Rule-Based Regional Order in the Asia-Pacific. Outline of my presentations, contrary to conventional views, Asia is not being integrated. In my understanding, now we are seeing two Asias are emerging in the rule-based liberal orders. So how we should respond to these new situations? Firstly, we should understand what is going on in this part of the world. I would explain quite unique nature of international relations of these regions. And responding to new challenges, we need to look beyond US-China relations. So in my understanding, we are now living in the era of so-called the rest of Asia. So rest of Asia will play more important roles in shaping new international relations of the Asia-Pacific. How Japan have been responding? So Japan now moving southward. And finally, going to challenges for Japan. So now, Asia, we are now seeing different Asias emerging. Two Asias are coming out. So first Asia is in search of deeper harmonization or deeper integrations based on harmonization, domestic institutions, political regime, human rights, rule of law, and also harmonization of domestic institutions underlined by liberal norms, both economics and security. The other Asia are being reluctant to accept the harmonization of domestic institutions and also reluctant to make a strict commitment to international rules and norms. And those countries are taking so-called rooting around strategies in loosely organized liberal international orders. They are not accepting fully existing international rules and norms, nor refusing those international rules. They are looking for third way, rooting around. So our task is not just sustaining, but also further enhancing rule-based international liberal orders in Asia. So unique characteristics of emerging international relations in these regions. So conventional views, mostly focusing on US-China relations. This bilateral relation will shape the future of the Asia-Pacific. And there are so many scenarios. On the one hand, US-China condominium or G2, and on the other hand, extreme US-China Cold War type of confrontations. Or some people predict US continued hegemony, or China established regional hegemonies. But in my understanding, none will happen in foreseeable futures. So US and China both, the many vulnerabilities and constraints internally and externally. In the United States, a divided politics, quite difficult to get national consensus. In China, serious internal instabilities, but also a lot of external challenges. So United States are still quite strong, but no longer a full-fledged regional hegemonic powers. On the other hand, China is not full-fledged regional rising powers. So both a lot of constraints and vulnerabilities. And also, between two countries, deep economic interdependence, so-called economic mud, mutually assured destruction are being formed between two countries. And both the US-China putting a priority on economic development rather than fighting war. And also between two countries, many policy coordinating mechanisms are already established. And also, economic development in today's world are mostly based on regional, region-wide production, finance, production network, and finance and investment networks. So neither the US nor China can dominate this region-wide production networks. And also huge gap in the political, economic, social values, and also future shape of international relations between the United States and China. So US-China relations overall quite tense, but cooperation in some functional areas could be possible. And also, the both US-China need the support of the so-called rest of Asia to pursue their own policy agenda. And now, if we look at current regional situations, we are seeing there are so many critical, important players and institutions in Asia, such as our, and they are not just the pawn of US-China relations. So we, in Asia, we have countries having a substantial economic, military, and also bargaining powers in the great games, such as Japan, India, ASEAN, and so forth. And those countries are resisting the construction of the US-China centered regional orders. Oh, I'll skip some part. So in my understanding, future policy direction of the rest of Asia will have enormous impact on the future rule-based liberal order of the regions. And Japan and India are key players among the rest of Asia. And Japan, Japan have been responding to new challenges. So Japan now moving southward. Of course, our alliance with the United States is critical for our peace and prosperity. But now Japan is looking beyond bilateral alliance with the United States. So we are enhancing the relation with India, Australia, ASEAN countries, and also ASEAN as the regional institutions. In the economies, Japan have been pursuing quite actively regional trade arrangement through TPP, Trans-Pacific Partnership, RCEP, East Asian-based Comprehensive Economic Partnership, and also bilateral FTA with those countries. And the investment, now Japanese private companies are aggressively making investment in southern part of Asia. So if you go to Southeast Asia, many people saying now is the second wave of Japan's investment in Southeast Asia. So now, the Japan's investment to China sharply declining, but on the other hand, the Japan's investment to Southeast Asia are expanding quite largely. Now, I think Japan's investment to Southeast Asia more than three times larger than Japan's investment to China. And the ODA also have been enhanced to promote connectivities among Southeast Professor Asian countries.
Kuchi, yeah, defense. To
okay.
Wind up. Thank you.
So, anyway, I and challenges are, but as I mentioned, the in Asia, some countries, especially China, are now taking so-called routing around strategies, neither rejecting the rule-based liberal order nor fully accepting tightly organized liberal order, touching upon harmonization of domestic institutions and also strict commitment to international rules and norms. So we may see our two Asias underlined by different rules and norms may emerge in the coming decades. So our Japan task to discourage the rest of Asia to follow the bandwagoning on China-led routing around strategies. And probably the big challenge are for Japan's India relations are India's understanding of international rules or future vision of international relations of the Asia Pacific is more synchronized with those of China rather than those of Japan. How we, Japan and India, can overcome these fundamental differences could be a most important policy agenda in the coming years and decades. Thank you very
Thank
much.
Thank you very much, Professor yep. Kikuchi. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. It's okay. Now may I request Ambassador Rangachari to address us.
Kulkarni Sahab, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, I think, Mr. Chairman, you're going to be more upset with me because I have a text which is much longer than posing. So, but I have done something which I will mention in a minute. First of all, I want to felicitate the ORF. Yesterday was the Chinese New Year. In 2 days' time, we're going to have Japan Foundation Day. So you have chosen a very, very apt time period to have this conference. Now, this is what I'm going to do. Because the time is short, I'm going to first read my conclusions. And you stop me at any time. Now, first of all, peace and development are essential for the entire Asia-Pacific region. China has done very well on the developmental front. We are talking about peace and prosperity. So on the prosperity front, China has done very, very well. It is now the second largest economy in the world and projected to become the largest by 2050. I'll show you a graph just to illustrate that. That will save some time. This is the PricewaterhouseCoopers. This is about 3 months old. This is where you see 2030, 2050, China, India, United States, and Japan's ranking. I think the Indonesia and Brazil that you see in 2050 may or may not work out because Brazil, as we know, is presently in some difficulty. But this is what the picture might look like in 2050. And I'll come in a minute to the implications for India. And Ambassador Alok Prasad, to the end, he was talking in terms of how we perceive ourselves. I think it's very important for India to make that mental transition and also policy transition from being a leader of a global trade union to being part of global management. Whether we have done it, I'm not sure. It's not enough to say we are net security provider, but we have to, in our own minds, be clear whether we are part of global management or not. (Clears throat) China, specifically here, there are some goals which are specific to China, which is the two centenaries. One is 2021, which is the centenary of the foundation of the Communist Party of China, and 2049, which is the centenary of the establishment of the People's Republic. And they have certain goals which they have sent. I won't go into the details to save time. But very quickly, if the economic goals are to be met, then the 7%, which Xi Jinping last year called the new normal rate of growth for China, is kind of an arithmetic calculation in the reverse direction. So if you don't get to 7%, and now this year has been revised downward to 6.9, and maybe if I have time, I'll mention to you what the projections are since December last year about the, you know, in the light of the changes that are taking place in the Chinese economy. If that is not attained, then what happens? And whether or not the centenary goals can be achieved or not. Now, in China, if you have economic difficulties, it could compound political problems. Asian countries, I think this is something which has been mentioned by earlier speakers also, need to work together. And this is where India and Japan come together, because we have shared values, democracy, tolerance, pluralism, open society. We have common interests, congruence of political, economic, and strategic interests. And there I would add one point to what Ambassador Alok Prasad was saying earlier. And you, Mr. Chairman, also mentioned about this continuity. There was always continuity on the economic side. Continuity on the political side is a more recent phenomenon. I remember you mentioned earlier about my long years dealing with East Asia. It was very, very difficult to get the Japanese Foreign Office, the Japanese Defense Ministry, and other, that is, non-economic ministries, to have substantive discussions with India on strategic issues. And then, you know, generally the commitment to the basic principles that both India and Japan share. I'll not go into the details, but these are, many of these are contained in the vision statement that was issued following Mr. Abe's visit in December. Now, what is China's role going to be? China's rise is something which we are seeing has happened. So what is the likely impact? What kind of role will China come to play? What is the direction in which rising China will seek to refashion the world? And please, I think to the Indian audience, it is important to remember, we are also seeking to refashion the world. We have some ideas in that regard. So are the Indian and Chinese views in this regard in congruence, or are they not in congruence? What would be the value system on which an economically and military powerful China will base its global leadership on? Would China follow in the Western footsteps and evolve towards individual freedoms and rights after a general level of economic uplift? Now here, I think for us Indians, it's very important to remember that we are probably the only example in history where we have followed democracy and economic development side by side. Even in the West, democracy came much, much later. There's a lot of history. There's not enough time, so I won't go into that. But this is something that everyone is aware of. Would the Chinese base themselves on the same post-war values, which is, you know, rule of law, individual freedom, human rights? Would the political system be representative and participatory democracy? I have some slides later on quoting Xi Jinping, Wen Jiabao, Hu Jintao, and others on democracy. And it's a completely different view of democracy than what we in India might have, or what Japan might have. Would the economic system be market-oriented rather than state-controlled? Last year, this is 2016, so 2013, there was a party plenum in which they made a shift in theoretical terms. And the Politburo and the Central Committee endorsed a line which was to give primacy to the markets. What you're seeing in the Chinese stock market, and I have a very interesting slide later on, if I have time, I will show you that. That is one of the results of trying to give the stock markets primacy. Remember that in China, the stock markets do not play a very important role, as perhaps it might even in India. The percentage of GDP that the stock markets account for is very, very nominal. And yet, It is a sign of how the government is going to deal with the market, whether it is going, for example, 2 years ago, towards the end of 2014, there were advertisements in radio, television, etc., encouraging people to invest. Then, when the stock market went out of control, the government intervened, suspended trading for a period of time, and then changed the rules it itself had formed. And then, towards the end of the year, they even said, those who have made losses, we will compensate them. Now, this is not how a market can function. So this is a learning process for the government also. And in international relations, would dialogue and peaceful means, or the threat or use of force, be the guiding principle? Likely trends in the coming decades. First, the shift to center of gravity from the Atlantic to the Indo-Pacific region is now increasingly come to be accepted. Two, this is something that I have mentioned, the change in the economic size of China, Japan, India, United States, and so on. If you take these projections, and actually they work out in practice, China will be 50 trillion, this is by 2050. United States will be 40 trillion, and India will be $30 trillion economy. So it also imposes certain obligations on India. If we are that large an economy, if you're third largest economy, of course, in a sense, we are going back to the pre-colonial, pre-imperial days when China and India together used to account for something like 40% of global output. But then China and India did not have any international obligations to maintain. Now, if we have international obligations to maintain, how are we individually, collectively, how are we going to either react to it or discharge them? India would also have become the most populous nation by 2050. So this is a demographic factor which is not only in operation in Japan, but also in China in a fairly big way.
Another minute and a half.
Okay. Okay, these are the other things that I wanted to draw as conclusion, that global peace may not be under threat in the same way it was in the first half of the 20th century. That is not having these world wars, interstate wars, etc., but more by non-state actors and so on. There are new threats, international threats that have emerged, like, for example, terrorism, cyber security, etc. The peace dividend that Europe had hoped for has not really been achieved in Europe. You know what the state is, I won't go into the details there. China is one country which has actually demonstrated success on the economic front, so has India. Question is whether India can sustain it. What is the post-war international system based on? There are a lot of details here. The one point I want to flag is that FDR, President Roosevelt, at the time of the end of the Second World War, he conceived of United States, the Soviet Union, the then Soviet Union, Britain and China being the four policemen of the world. This is the words that Roosevelt used, the four policemen. And then he also spelled out what they were supposed to do. Now, this is not the same China that Roosevelt was looking at, because that was Chiang Kai-shek's China, which is now on the Republic of China on Taiwan. Now you have a communist regime, People's Republic of China. Will they play the same role? And in what way this conception is going to change if, and this is where the Chinese approach towards the world order that comes into play. Well, there's a great deal here. We don't have time for all this. Okay, very quickly, this whole thesis that the US is on the decline and China is on the rise, and consequences and so on, this is very largely fueled by a lot of American scholars. But when you look at today's economic realities, United States is showing very robust economic growth, whereas in the case of China, some doubts are creeping in. The latest Davos meeting last month, there were many estimates that this 6.9 or 7% growth that is being talked about is actually closer to 3.5%, which doesn't serve China's purpose at all, not only in terms of achieving the centenary goals, but also because of the social pressures it creates. Because unlike in the case of India, where if because of lack of economic performance, a party goes out of power, somebody else comes in, it is accepted as normal. In China, the Communist Party is very clear that political power, it is the monopoly of the Communist Party of China. Therefore, since they are not willing to give up power in case of lack of economic performance and the people not accepting continuity, and that's the legitimacy is based on, so they create problems for themselves if they don't achieve economic targets, and that creates other problems in terms of maintaining social order, discipline, and then how they react globally. This, again, a very quick point. The Chinese, you know, military power has grown, and this is a historical fact that as economic power grows, military power also grows. Partly it is in order to defend the economic gains that you have made, partly it is in order to create new realities. In the case of China, there has been enormous investment in defense. The defense budget has grown a great deal. The interesting argument given by the Chinese officially and by the Chinese defense minister, the former defense minister Liang Kuanglie, for example, said this in Singapore. He said that our weapons are second and third generation. Weapons in the West are of fourth generation, moving on to fifth generation. Now, you see the comparison there is not with Asia. It is with the West, primarily the United States. The trouble is all of China's problems are with its neighbors, none of whom are developed countries except Japan, and none are in the fourth or fifth generation category. So how do you reconcile this? The ability, the increased sort of military might on the one hand, unresolved problems, and then how do you use one to correlate to the other? How do you solve these problems in association with others? And related to this is the question of core interests. Okay. I'll just show you quickly that this is the stock market slide I wanted to show. And there are, I'm sure, many people who are connected to the market or follow the market. And the next slide is interesting, because if you haven't made any sense of it, nobody has, because that's how the stock market has been operating. Then there is also the Chinese reaction to what the global economists are saying about China's growth rate, etc. And finally, the India-Japan cooperation in this context. As I mentioned earlier, we have shared values, shared interests, and therefore it is imperative, axiomatic, that we should cooperate. And now that Japan's political approach towards India has changed, I think we have a propitious atmosphere in which this can take place. Thank you.
Thank you. You were quite right, Ambassador Rangachari, in underlining the fact that the strategic dialogue with Japan is a 15-year-old phenomenon. That is absolutely correct. We didn't have anything near that before, and I'm sure we'll hear more about that from Admiral Chauhan, who has been studying the India-Japan defense relationship, especially the maritime cooperation, for a long time.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you to the ORF for giving me this opportunity to present some maritime perspectives of peace and prosperity in the Indo-Pacific. But before I begin, I'd like to offer a note of my own personal condolences with regard to the untimely departure of Radha Vishwanathan, a colleague, a friend, and the wife of a very eminent naval surgeon, whose departure leaves all of us impoverished. I also want to give two quick caveats. One is that I'm going to talk about maritime. Maritime is not the same as naval. The second is I'm going to talk about security. Security is not the same as military. Bear these in mind. When we discuss Japan, we have a realization that in maritime terms, India and Japan's security, that is the pursuit of peace and prosperity, is shaped by the same two foundational axioms, and the first of these axioms is the articulation of our common core national interest of both India and Japan, which is to assure the economic, material, and societal well-being of our respective people. No articulation of a core national interest can be more basic than this. It is from here that you realize that if there is to be a people of India or a people of Japan, then the territorial integrity of that country needs to be assured so that the people are from that country, otherwise they are not. The second axiom is what brings the maritime focus to this entire discussion and debate, and that is that both India and Japan wish to use the seas in ways that are for their own respective purposes, while simultaneously preventing others from using the seas in ways that are to their disadvantage. And insofar as India is concerned, the reasons why we want to use the seas for our own purposes, while simultaneously preventing others from using them in ways that are to our disadvantage, are, of course, collectively known as our national maritime interests, and these are now on your screen. I'm going to run them really quickly because I found it astonishing that despite the wealth of information that was obtained in the first session, we just didn't have a single mention of the word the blue economy. And yet the blue economy will either drive India or it will derail India. One of the two things will happen. This is the last bus that India can afford to miss. There is no more bus for the next 150 years. The first of our maritime interests is the protection from sea-based threats to our territorial integrity, ensuring stability in our maritime neighborhood. Ladies and gentlemen, we have a neighborhood which has far too few neighbors and too many hoods. The third is the creation and development and sustenance of a blue economy, and this incorporates three fundamental factors: the promotion and protection of India's maritime resources and offshore infrastructure, both within and beyond the maritime zones of India. The second is the promotion, protection, and safety of our overseas and coastal seaborne trade and our sea lines of communication, including the ports that constitute the nodes of this trade. And from there, we come to multimodal transportation and the issues that were raised in the earlier session by Captain Sequeira. And the third is the support to the marine scientific research that we undertake, including that in Antarctica, because Antarctica currently determines the Indian monsoon. And that's why we are there. Provision of support and extrication options to our diaspora, of which I need to emphasize little. Provision of holistic maritime security, that is freedom from threats arising in or from the seas. And lastly, gaining and maintaining a regionally favorable geostrategic and geopolitical maritime position. Now, the maritime security of India is, of course, a function of three features. One is the geographic conformation of the Indo-Pacific oceanic expanse. The second is India's maritime interests, which I've just mentioned. And the third is the interplay of the geostrategies of other maritime powers with that of India. And as Robert Kaplan said, maps like civilizations, maps matter. So I'm going to run the Indian Ocean aspect before you very rapidly. And then to tell you some of the issues that are relevant to this. If you look at the Australian segment, you'll see the Timor and Arafura Seas. You've got the Andaman Seas. You've got the Gulf of Martaban, which for North Indians is not where your mother keeps her pickle. The Bay of Bengal, there's the Gulf of Cambat, the Gulf of Kutch, the Arabian Sea, the Gulf of Oman, the Persian Gulf, the Gulf of Aqaba, the Red Sea, the Gulf of Aden, and the Mozambique Channel and the swing around from the Cape of Good Hope and east of Madagascar. Now, in this area, unlike the Atlantic and unlike the Pacific, there are only 8 choke points or gateways that we need to concern ourselves with, which offer access and egress into and out of this area. The Strait of Hormuz, you've got the Suez Canal, you've got the Strait of Bab el-Mandeb, otherwise known as the Gateway of Tears. At the bottom there is the Cape of Good Hope, which is a weather generated choke point. On the eastern seaboard, you've got Malacca, which everybody knows of. You've got Sunda, which is less well known. The Strait of Lombok, which is even well less known, and yet it is crucial because all major movement of Chinese supertankers carrying oil goes through the Strait of Lombok and not through Malacca. And then you've got Ombai Wetar, and even when I talk to a naval audience and I say Ombai Wetar, many of them say same to you. And yet, this is the only strait that allows nuclear-propelled submarines to proceed underwater between the Pacific and the Indian Ocean. Anybody's nuclear submarines. And therefore, since we operate these nuclear submarines, it's a strait of some importance to us. In this area, there are many, many insecurities, many of which have been touched upon by the eloquent speakers before me, but none of them top energy as an insecurity of major dimensions. We have energy right at the top of our field. So if China and Japan both have a Malacca dilemma, then India and Japan share a Hormuz nightmare. There is a huge problem over here. If you look at our figures of imports, as has already been mentioned, in terms of the percentage value of oil, crude oil imports that we're getting, we are importing somewhere around 80% of our import of our crude oil requirements, which means, which translates roughly to just under 4 million barrels of crude oil per day. And that's, there are huge changes going on in our strategic construct to see where this oil should be coming from. The conventional wisdom is Saudi Arabia, but yet in 2015, Nigeria is our single largest import source for crude oil. Venezuela has overtaken Saudi Arabia. So we're not talking about static things. We can't have a BTP circuit running. BTP, for those of you who don't know, stands for blazer, tie, and pen. That means these are the three things you've got in your strategic advisor. In truth, of course, you have to keep studying this. It doesn't work as simply as it might appear. And therefore, for us, the criticality to India of the Hormuz and the Strait of Bab el-Mandeb is enormous. Nigerian oil has to come through the Suez Canal. It has to cross the Strait of Bab el-Mandeb before it comes in. Venezuelan oil has to come around the Cape of Good Hope. And therefore, this is... This is a fairly busy area, and there are a large number of international players here. We have the United States predominating with PAYCOM, with CENTCOM, with AFRICOM, and of course, apart from that, we have various combined task forces in the region. You've also got individual countries in which, of course, Japan figures. So this is a busy, busy area, and our attention on the eastern seaboard must remain focused. If we're going to deal with Japan, it must remain focused upon the criticality of Indonesia, because Indonesia offers and controls all the straits that connect the Indian and the Pacific Oceans. And as we look at maps, the issues relating to the South China Sea are fairly familiar to people. Not very many people know how to define the Indian Ocean or the Arabian Sea or the South China Sea, and international hydrographic publications lie outside the realm of knowledge of most of government. The territorial claims in the South China Sea are well known. I will not dwell upon these, except to say that the nine dash line encompasses areas such as the Natuna offshore gas fields of Indonesia, and it is a hugely important structure for India. So while we worry about the Indian Ocean for the bulk of our strategic dialogue, we need to look at the South China Sea increasingly closely. As far as Japan is concerned, the East China Sea is of monumental concern. The Sea of Japan, it hasn't even got an official name yet. Let me jump straight off to the last slide, where we've got, last two slides, where we've got historical cooperation, growing bilateral trade, shared security interests, and shared maritime challenges as the canvas on which we must paint our strategic construct. Insofar as maritime, there are serious ones. We have, both countries have grossly insufficient bureaucratic expertise about the maritime field. We have complex procurement and weapon export procedures. There is in India definitely inadequate shipbuilding capacity. There is no capacity and capability of to talk about with regard to coastal security, and so on and so forth. Let me jump straight to the last figure, which is climate change and sea level rises and vulnerabilities. India, insofar as the number of people who will be affected by a 1 meter rise of sea level, the number of people is the highest on the planet. Everybody thinks of Maldives, but it's not the Maldives, it's India. It's number one in 2008, and it will remain number one in 2050. Climate change has enormous security implications. Insofar as opportunities are concerned, they are flashed on your screen. You have the blue economy. It is central, once again, let me reiterate. And the joint survey for gas hydrates is already seeing cooperation between India and Japan. Undersea mining is a major future area of opportunity. Trade, we have already touched upon in the previous session as well. And there is a need for us to create a robust regional security architecture which builds upon structures such as the Indian Ocean Naval Symposium and the Western Pacific Naval Symposium, quite apart from the IORA. Let me just show you one slide each of these two oceans. It's just a run. I'm not going to speak. Take a look at the slide. As was pointed out right in the very beginning, what we are to look at most specifically is the East Asia Summit, because that's the only one that actually affords connectivity between India and Japan at a national level. On the Indian Ocean side, we have a more exciting situation. Whilst earlier, up till 1981, we have no connection with any of the regional constructs, this starts to change with a naval movement of the Western Pacific Naval Symposium in 1988, where India starts to figure for the first time. The IOR-ARC, or as it is now called, the IORA, develops, and now we have IPSA having been formed between India, Brazil, and South Africa. But yet, it is the Indian Ocean Naval Symposium which offers the maximum connectivity. However, this is occurring at the naval end. It needs to be lifted and made conjoined with IOR or with IORA or such other construct as Japan and India will be bilaterally or multilaterally able to develop. Insofar as China is concerned, this is what we see. I hope this scares you, because it certainly scares us. And if you look at that configuration, it is remarkably similar, if not identical, to the One Belt, One Road construct. And so what you're seeing in the One Belt, One Road construct, I submit to you, is simply a marketing strategy, brilliantly marketed, but marketing strategy by the People's Republic of China. Thank you.
Thank you very much. You covered a lot of ground in a lot of water. Thank you so much, Admiral Chauhan. And may I request now Dr. Rajiv Kumar to make his remarks.
Thank you, Chair. Thanks to the URF for having me here. And I have a tough job following up on the Admiral, with all the maps. I want to make 5 points here in my 10 minutes that I've got. And the first point, and I must preface it by saying that I have written, co-authored 3 books on national security for India, and also been a member of the National Security Advisory Board. And I'm saying that I'm aware of the security concerns, external security concerns. And despite that, I want to say that the biggest contribution India can make for security in the Indo-Pacific region is to focus on its national economy, is to focus on its domestic economy. And that is that's something very often forgotten. We get very complacent hearing this area, the figures of 40 trillion, 30 trillion, et cetera, et cetera. I had made once a presentation at Davos where I had presenting different scenarios for India. And ladies and gentlemen, believe me, the difference, the power of the exponential is such that the difference between growing at 5 or 6% or growing at 9 or 10% can be in India, which is an $8 trillion economy in 2046, when you have 100th year of your independence, or in India, which is a $40 trillion economy. Now, the fact is, therefore, that I think our policymakers, our leaders, our intellectuals should not escape away from the domestic realities by conjuring up these huge images, you know, and I'm afraid, Admiral, your maps sort of tend to take us to that sort of side, because, you know, India's role in the Indo-Pacific region would be zilch if we have millions of our own youth milling around in our streets because the demographic, you know, the so-called demographic dividend would have by then turned into a demographic nightmare. That's my first point. And I think it's an important one to remember in the context of discussing security. The second point that I would make is that we know, all of us know, that the economic gravity of the globe is shifting to Asia. That's been now, it's common, it's cliche. But for that, as we all hear, the geostrategic gravity would also shift to Asia. And in Asia, there are these three giant powers, economies, India, China, and Japan. And we can't escape away from that. So far, what has happened is that these three giant economies have agreed among themselves, implicitly or otherwise, And my friend Alok, my classmate Alok, mentioned to the fact that we should let ASEAN mediate this relationship. And the other people, other set of people will tell you that, that's the most comfortable, way, because they are the ones who are there, they're 200 million people. You know, we are, among the three of us, we are about, 2.5 billion people. But the other set of people, and I lived 10 years in the Philippines, would tell you, not really, it's the US which guarantees, or which is the underlying power of the Asian geostrategic peace. Both of them, I feel, it's time, I think, let me put it this way, that we should be brave enough to start a trilateral dialogue between these three economies at some level or the other. Unless this trilateral dialogue happens, the chances of misunderstanding and the chances of India being put into an anti-China coalition by people who are not friends of India in some sense or friends of China, I think are immense. And you can see this everywhere, you can see it all the time. And therefore, I think the sooner think tanks like the ORF or my own, the Center for Policy Research, start a trilateral dialogue between India, China, and Japan, the better off we would be to take care of the coming, shift in the geostrategy for Asia, geostrategic shift of power to Asia. Because I think at the end of the day, ASEAN is just far too small to be able to meet our needs. To have all your track two dialogues in Singapore, I think this time has come that we should try and shift to some other location. And I said this in Singapore itself, and I was, of course, since then been a persona non grata. But nonetheless, that is how it is. The third point that I want to make, ladies and gentlemen, is that when we were writing this book called Non-Alignment 2.0, a member of our group was also General Prakash Menon. And just like the Admiral, he did an admiral job. And by the way, maps are absolutely critical. Thank you so much. And this is beautiful. He came into our room one day and put up the India map upside down, with the land borders at the bottom and the tip and the dagger going into the Indian Ocean on the top. And suddenly we realize what the Admiral has said so admirably, the importance of the blue economy, the Indian Ocean, etc., and all the threats and dangers, and we just change our way of thinking. I think that needs to be done much more. That needs to be done much more. That needs to be propagated much more. But in the current context, I think what we need to do is to bring Indo-Japan cooperation into this. And I think India-Japan, rather than have the only thing like, there is a Malabar, there is the quadrilateral, etc. If we can get an Indo-Japanese collaboration with IOR countries, you talked about lifting the naval to the economic, and India still doesn't have, unfortunately, the wherewithal to do that. It needs partners to be able to be effective in our littoral states, ranging from Africa to Southeast Asia. And I say that I'm hypothesizing that India-Japan partnership can actually be a very effective partnership in giving sustenance to this Indian Ocean Rim, concept. And here, I think it is important just to add here that Africa is very often forgotten. That's the rising continent. That will be the area for tomorrow. And therefore, and the Chinese have stolen a march over us on this, Indo-Japanese cooperation for African countries and East African countries as a part of the IOR strategy would produce huge amounts of advantages and gains for us. And the last point, ladies and gentlemen, is about just as India is important for the Asia, the Asian security, South Asia is actually key to what's happening, going to happen in the Indo-Pacific region. As I said earlier in my chairman's remark, this region already is about 1.5, 1.6 billion. It's going to touch 2 billion by the time you're 2040. The largest concentration of poverty is in this region in the world today. Some of our indices are even worse than sub-Saharan Africa. There is a huge amount, of animosity, misunderstanding, conflict, two nuclear power, nuclear power countries, amazing amount of, misunderstandings, etc. And yet, there is a prospect that China could, and the maps that the Admiral showed, if you were talking about the pearl of strings that they have in mind, and which they have declared openly at the Kunming, seminar year after year after year,
you would see that this neighborhood is going to become much more contested than what it is today. And that contest, we cannot afford to lose. And if we lose that contest, of course, then what will happen is that the Indo-Pacific region will become some sort of an illusion, if you like, or a dream. Here is where I've been talking so often to my Japanese counterparts, starting from Saiki-san downwards and earlier. In fact, even before that, I forget the name of Domichi. I think that was the best. That why doesn't Japan collaborate with India and focus on developing South Asian regional cooperation? It can be a part of intra-industry trade. Japanese companies can lead that. I did a project for DHL of all the German. They had the foresight to say that they want to develop a hub and spoke model in South Asia, and therefore looking at other markets and all the non-tariff barriers which are controlling all of that. Japan can do the same. Toyota can start importing components from all over South Asia into central assembly plants, and etc., etc. None of that somehow so far had, you know, evoked any response, because to begin with, I remember Domichi-san, etc., were in some sense scared of China. How would China, you know, react to this? That period is now over. So I think what today we can do with Japan, and Japan should, this is the right place to talk, is to develop South Asia as a regionally cooperated economic space, and then if you bring in Afghanistan on one end and Myanmar on the other, you're opening up Central Asia and ASEAN. And therefore, the ADB, where I used to work, has this wonderful diagram where they show, you know, all these countries linked, and they're a garland of cooperation across Asia, and the missing link is South Asia. If you could do that, you could bring a lot of security to Indo-Pacific region. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you. Thank you, Bhagavad.